Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to Peace United Methodist Church. My name is Jim Burlow. I'm the pastor of Peace Church, and it is great to see you this morning as we gather together in this virtual setting to worship and praise God as one community of faith. Before we get started with all of our worship this morning, we want to go over a few updates with you and a few things happening in the life of the church. First of all, we hope that you've been enjoying those phone calls that you've been receiving from our phone call team. They've been reaching out to everyone that we have a phone number for in our directory just to check in, see how you're doing, and to build this sense of community that we so desperately need during this time. And so, if you have not received a call from us, please be sure to email our church office and let us know what your current phone number is so that we can be sure to add you to our list. We're excited that we're here with week number two of our virtual worship experience, and we were thrilled that that things went so great last week, and we're praying that we have another wonderful time of worship together this morning. Just to kind of give you an update, in an effort for social distancing, we'll be having our music led from pre-recorded tapings of different songs, and so just want to, you know, keep that in front of you, that even though these pre-recordings are not happening live, that we can still together worship. And so we encourage you, whenever it is that we're singing or whenever we're praying, that you engage with this service, that you sing out loud, that you go to a state of prayer, that you become a part of this, participating in worship, not just a casual observer watching this. And so we invite you to engage in that way. So here's a few things that we've been doing over the past week or so that we want to keep in front of you. The first is that our if you're looking for a way to serve, a way to give, a way to help the community, you can go to our website, and there's a link for donating to Second Harvest Food Bank. That's a really great mission and a great ministry in the community, and you can donate directly to them right there from your home, and then they will purchase the necessary food needed to keep their shelves stocked. We also know that you probably are thinking about people, maybe even within our congregation or immediately right here within our community, who might be in need at this time. And so if you want to donate to our Benevolence Fund, which is a fund that goes to helping those who contact us that are in need, you can go right to our giving page, and there's a link there to be able to donate directly to that Benevolence Fund to be able to help people in need. If you find yourself as someone who is homebound right now, that you don't feel like you can leave your house, maybe you fall into that high-risk category and you just don't feel like it's safe for you to go out currently, we have a team of people that are available and willing to run some simple errands for you. And so all you have to do is contact our church office and let Jana know, and she'll get you connected with that team, and then someone will find out what it is that you need, and you'll work out with them the logistics on them running those errands for you. But please take advantage of this opportunity if you feel like you can't leave your house, because we have people that are willing to help. And then last but not least, one of the things we're really excited about in terms of updates is our new community groups that started this weekend. We have these virtual groups that are meeting through the application called Zoom. And so all you need to do is download the software for Zoom onto your computer, onto your tablet, onto your phone, and you can jump right into one of the many different virtual groups that we have gathering pretty much every day throughout the week. And so you can go to our website and you can find the listing of all of the different groups, the different themes that the groups have, and how to connect with that special, specific virtual community group. And so we encourage you during this time to stay connected with your church family through one of these virtual community groups. We want to encourage you to continue to pray for those who are in need within our community, those who are experiencing financial difficulties as of this social distancing that we're doing. And so we just lift those families and those persons up in prayer. We also ask that you continue to consider how you can give to our church. And so we still have a full slate of ministries happening, and we're trying to be the church in the community at this time. And so if you can continue to give your offering, your tithe to the church, it will be very beneficial to the life of this church, to our staff, and to everything that's happening. And so you can go to our giving page, peaceumcgiving.org, and that is a secure website. If you're worried about it being unsecure, it is absolutely a secure and safe option to give. Yes, there is a small percentage of a cost that goes to processing those donations, but I think it's like, don't quote me on this, but a little over 1%. And so feel free to take advantage of that opportunity to give right from where you're sitting right now. You could also, if that doesn't work for you, you can go online and download this form that will set up automatic withdrawal from your bank account so that you don't even have to worry about it, that that'll happen automatically in however fashion you kind of set it up. And then also you can always mail a check to our church office. We're checking our mail regularly, and you can mail a check directly to us. Last thing is with our Holy Week activities, you might have seen the notification from our bishop this week that we are being asked not to gather in person for Easter, but we still will have our Easter service and our Palm Sunday service. Both of those services will happen in the same format we're doing this service, where we'll meet at 9:30 virtually for a live Facebook feed. And so we will still worship during Holy Week. It'll just be in this virtual setting. But we do have a few, you know, other activities that were scheduled. So our soup and pie supper is canceled. We will not be having our Good Friday service, and our obviously our sunrise service will not be happening as well. But our bunny run, which we're excited about, is not going to be canceled. That's going to be rescheduled for sometime in the fall. And so if you were looking and anticipating to being a part of that fun community outreach event, we are looking forward to hosting that sometime in September, October, or November. We'll figure it out when and let you know. And so those are some of the announcements and the things that are happening in the life of the church. One of the most important things that we can do, especially in this virtual format, is connect with one another. Somebody said to me earlier this week how they were struggling with seeing all of the notifications and the comments coming up during the service. And yeah, it can be a little distracting, but there's also value to it in that we are interacting and engaging with one another in worship. So we want to encourage you right now to jump on there, say hello to some people, maybe pick out or call out one person specifically and make sure you greet them as we welcome one another in the name of Christ. So let's go ahead and do that right now. Let's greet each other.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Are you guys there? Are you guys there?
Yeah.
Yay. Good morning. We're going to do this again. Last week, I called a whole bunch of our friends on the phone to help me with the children's story. And I know there's a whole bunch of you kids out there watching with your families. And I hope that you checked the Facebook page, because there's an activity sheet that helps you connect with what's happening here in worship. But the big question I have today is, I'm going to go say your name and ask you what you think the word sin means. Okay, and I'm going to start with Ryan. What do you think sin means? So a sin is something that you do that, say that again, that you think is wrong, but God doesn't want you to do. Is that what you said?
Yeah.
All right. Okay, Ari, what do you think sin is? We chose something to do and God's not happy with it. All right, what about Amelie? What do you think?
Sin is something someone does to hurt a person, a certain person, or somebody or something.
That's good. How about you, Aurora? Are you there?
She's not here.
Okay, how about Kaden?
Sin is something very bad that you did.
Okay.
That you don't want to take credit for. Okay. And yet God knows you did it.
Libby, do you have something?
Grace.
Okay, and Madeline, how about you? So we do something that God doesn't want us to do. I think those are all really good answers. But the simplest definition of sin is doing something that separates us from God. And a lot of times people think that sin is something that we're doing that's bad or wrong, but anything that separates us from God could be thought of as a sin. Now, I know, especially from our class yesterday, I saw a lot of you, and we talked a lot about how we have a little bit of fear, or maybe we're feeling anxious or scared. Those are all really normal feelings. And even grown-ups have those feelings. But sometimes those feelings can keep us from remembering the promise of God. And there's a lot of really good promises in this Bible that help us remember that God loves us and keeps us safe and wants us to remember that when we think of God, we can find peace. So when we're having these feelings, remember, don't let them take over so much that we forget the good promise of God. Now I'm going to pray, and first I'm going to say it, and then you guys copy, okay? All right. You guys ready? Dear God.
Yes. Dear God.
When I feel scared or anxious, I will remember that you love me.
I will remember that you love me.
And only want the best for me.
And only want the best for me.
And when I think of you, I can find peace.
Amen.
Amen. All right. Well, thank you, and we'll talk to you later. Bye.
Those kids are great, aren't they? And hopefully you were able to hear some of what they were saying, and regardless of whether you could hear every word or not, just knowing that we have children present with us right now in worship, gathered together with their families, is a beautiful and wonderful thing. And so now is a time where we go to the Lord in song. And so some of you, like me, might not be that confident in our singing ability, but we ask that in these moments, as we begin to lift up praise to our Lord, that you join us right where you are in singing these songs out loud. We have the lyrics attached to the video where you'll see the lyrics on the song, but also if you want to read the lyrics, we have a page on our website that will enable you to be able to go and see those lyrics. But either way you do it, join us in a spirit of worship now as we praise our God. Let's pray and let's sing.
Glorious day, you called my name.
I will trust the voice that speaks.
thank you so much for that great music. Now we are going into a time of prayer, and we're going to do something a little bit different this morning. I'm going to lead what we call a breath prayer, and it's pretty easy. I'm going to do some hand motions to get us started. You may want to participate in that way, but if you are bowing your head, that's fine. Whenever I say the words when, you breathe in, and when I say the words you, you breathe out. And then at the end of the prayer, I'm just gonna go on and you just keep breathing in that rhythmic manner, okay? Here we go, let's bow our heads. Holy and gracious Creator, breathe in. When fear and anxiety is created within, breathe out. You are full of love that frees us from its chains. When we feel threatened and scared or stressed, you are always in control. When we feel weak, tired, and out of sorts, you put your arms around us and comfort us. When we have lost hope and feel overwhelmed, you bring us refuge and melt away our worries and fears. When we pray for mental and physical and emotional health, you bring us strength and power and relief. Holy and gracious God, forgive us when we allow the negativity of the news to bring us down and distract us from you. Forgive us when we are impatient with others or angry because we don't see eye to eye with each other in this situation. And forgive us when we allow anxiety and stress to be the motivation behind everything we are doing. Thank you, God. Thank you, God, that when we stop and breathe and focus on you, that our spirits are refreshed and we can find the strength to continue on. Protect our minds. Fill us with life and peace. And don't let the ways of this world get in the way of our good and wonderful relationship with you. May we be transformed and strong, and most importantly, through it all, a witness to your good will. We ask all of this in your gracious and holy name. Amen. And now, as we prepare for our tithes and offerings, I want to remind you that you can go to peaceumcgiving.org and donate there. And let's take a few moments as Jonathan leads us in a time of meditation.
Sunshine of his face. Come.
Amen. So this morning we are continuing with our Lent series called Golgotha. It's these past few weeks we've been discussing these last words of Jesus before he loses his life on the cross. And so we've leaned in and we paid careful attention to these words that Christ fought to say with all of his might. And our hope is that through focusing on this terrible moment in Christ's life, that we can find assurance and comfort and hope ourselves in our own lives currently. And so let's begin this time with a word of prayer. Pray with me, please. Heavenly and gracious God, in these moments, help us to hear you. Help us to not turn away from the pain and the anguish because it's just too much to bear. Help us, Lord, to lift our heads high, knowing that your promise is that you win. And that in your victory, we can find hope. We can find meaning and purpose. That we can find victory all around us. We pray this in your holy and blessed name. Amen. So I recently received this email from someone who's been participating in worship throughout this series, and they were commenting to me how they always have struggled with this concept of Christ's crucifixion, with this reality of this act, and the thought, they said, of the Lord suffering in such a devastating and horrific state was just too much for them to bear, especially now, within all that we have going on in our world. But they went on to say how this series is bringing hope into their lives. And they found themselves throughout this series remembering this conversation that they had with someone who said to them, without Good Friday, there is no Easter. And that's where we find ourselves today, zeroing in on the reality of this tragic moment. Seeing the cross, seeing the death of Christ for what it really is. Tragic, but beautiful. Terrifying, but hopeful. Devastating, but triumphant. In this one short verse that we're going to read here in a moment, we won't hear the helpless cries of some martyr. We won't catch the last gasp of a life well lived. No, in this brief moment, the divine Redeemer assures all of us that the Lord's work is not done. In fact, it's just beginning. And so we're going to read this morning out of the book of John, the same book that we read last week from the New Testament. It's the fourth gospel. We'll be reading out of chapter 19, and we'll be reading verse 30. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." And then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. It is finished. Now, looking at this, we'd probably like to think that what Jesus is saying here is that he's done, that his life is over, that the pain and the suffering has come to an end, and his time here on earth is now complete. But is that really it? I mean, when you think about it, if that's what Jesus was trying to say, instead of saying, "It is finished," he probably would have said, "I am finished." So what if instead of this being a cry of defeat, this was a declaration of triumph in the midst of suffering? I mean, think about it. What if the cross itself, this thing that was an image of death and fear by the Roman Empire, what if in this moment, in that single statement, it was transformed into a symbol of courage and hope? You know, when we look at the Greek language, this statement, "it is finished," it's actually one word, tetelestai. Everybody go ahead and say that wherever you're sitting right now, just for fun, tetelestai. This word in Greek, it means completion. But it has a totally different sense to it than, you know, "Oh, I love the Golden Corral. I went up to the buffet 4 times and boy, I am stuffed. Tetelestai." No, the tone of this word is way more final. It suggests that there was this process taking place, that something was at work, and that process has now reached its full completion. There's nothing left to do. So let's take a look at a few ways in which this phrase was used in this day and age, and let's see if Jesus' use of this word can speak to us in our lives in the here and now. And so why don't we begin with the idea of slavery? Now, to say the word "enslaved" today, it conjures up all sorts of negative emotions and feelings and images, and rightfully so, right? To be enslaved to something, to be enslaved to someone, it can cause us to think of being oppressed, being misused, being held captive in some sort of way. But in this day and age, to be enslaved, it meant to be completely sold out, to be 100% dedicated to a person or to an entity. You know, there was a common cultural theme here of slave and master, meaning one was to do the full bidding of the other as a form of respect and reverence and honor. So it was common for the slave to report back to their master, to give them updates on the work that it was that they were doing. So when that task was finally completed, well, the servant would say to the master, "Tetelestai, it is finished," with this sense of pride and accomplishment. You know, Jesus making this statement, you could see that he's referencing this work that I'm called to do is now complete. And think about it, earlier when we see Jesus kneeling in the Garden of Gethsemane, he's praying with such anguish that he's sweating blood. And what does he ask of God? He says, "If it's possible, may this cup be taken from me. But then," he says, "yet not as I will, but as you will." There's this sense of Jesus surrendering to God's leading. Jesus is following through with God's plan for his life. Sure, it might have been challenging. It might have been scary. I mean, come on, let's be real. It was probably downright terrifying. But Jesus doesn't shy away from the calling. No, he's committed. He was dedicated. And no whip, and no chain, and no crown of thorns, and no brutal statement from the crowd, no challenge whatsoever would keep him from completing his task for his master. And so isn't the same expected of us? I mean, do we have the same dedication to the Lord? Are we willing to be enslaved to God? No matter how challenging, no matter how scary, no matter how confusing these times may be, are we sold out, so sold out, that we will do whatever it takes to follow God's will in our lives? Jesus says, tetelestai. Can we? Merchants also use this term. I recently had this issue with my car. It's a four-year-old car, right? And the engine was running a little bit rough. And so I took it into the shop. I assumed, you know, there was something, you know, it needed a tune-up or whatever. And so the mechanic, he calls me later and he says to me, yeah, it's the engine. And I was like, oh, really? Well, what's wrong with it or whatever? And he goes, no, Jim, it's your engine. The entire thing needs to be replaced. And so after I picked my jaw up off the floor, he started to tell me how the car was still under warranty, and so now they would begin this process of getting approval to use the warranty, and it would take a little bit of time. And so there I was, stuck, not knowing what was going to happen with my car, not able to even get a rental car at that point. And so I did what any normal person would do. I borrowed the church's 25-passenger bus. And it was great, you know, driving through the community, and now I'm backing up into the driveway, you know, and you hear the my kids, they thought I was crazy. My neighbors were confused, but the mechanic said it would only be 2 days. And so I figured, what's the big deal? I'm just going back and forth to church anyway. So a week later, when I still hadn't gotten my car back, I began to get a little worried. And then finally he calls me and he says, Jim, everything's approved and your car is done. And I'm thinking, great. So I hightail it over to the dealership as fast as I could. And it was so strange. It was strange being given the keys to my car, knowing that the engine had been completely replaced and was brand new. And that was it. I said to him, I said, you know, do I owe you anything? You know, should I get out my card? And he says, no. It's all taken care of. It's done. Tetelestai. Back in Jesus' day, if someone bought something from a merchant, the merchant would say to the purchaser, tetelestai, you've paid in full. You owe nothing more. And to take that a step further, if someone had a debt, right, that they were trying to pay off, and they did so completely, the merchant would say, tetelestai, your debt has been paid in full. You owe nothing more. Now, raise your hand if you think you're perfect, that you've done nothing wrong. Brandon Hoopengartner, put your hand down. We're just joking, right? None of us are perfect. We all share this sinful state of being. And as much as we don't like to admit it, all of us stand there at the foot of the cross watching Christ lose his life, and it's because of our sinful nature that Jesus is there. And while Jesus hangs there, breathing his final breaths, he looks at you and he looks at me and he says, the debt of your sin is paid in full. You owe nothing more. Tetelestai. It is finished. This term, it was also used with religious leaders. Back in Jewish culture, in ancient Jewish culture, these animal sacrifices would occur for people's atonement, which meant that they would be made right with God again. So basically, someone would take the best calf or lamb that they could find. I mean, the cream of the crop, the best of the best. And then they would sacrifice it to God in order to be forgiven. And so what they would do is they would bring that lamb to the high priest, and the high priest would take it, and the high priest was the only one that was allowed to enter into this special place in the temple called the Holiest of Holies. And it was there that this sacrifice would happen. Then, of course, the high priest would come back out of this special place and they would say to everyone gathered there, "Tetelestai, the blood of the Lamb covers the sin." And this would be all fine and good, of course, until the next season of sacrifice, where everyone would need to find the best animal again in order to go and be a part of this sacrificial offering again because of their ongoing need to be made right with God. And so Jesus dies on this cross. And in doing so, he becomes the perfect sacrifice. He's the best of the best. He's the cream of the crop. He's the ultimate of humanity. But he's not just the perfect sacrifice. The point in all of this is that he's the final sacrifice. Earlier in the book of John, Jesus says to the disciples who were giving him a hard time because he wasn't eating, Jesus says, "My food is to do the will of him who has sent me to complete his work." And just two chapters before this moment of Jesus on the cross, Jesus says while praying to God in the Garden of Gethsemane, "I glorified you on earth, God, by finishing the work that you called me to do." In fact, in three of the four Gospels, it's reported that as Jesus dies, the curtain that hung in the doorway to this holiest of holies place in the temple is torn in two. And all of this signifies that from this day forward, there would no longer need to be an animal sacrifice given to a high priest for our forgiveness. No, Jesus says, "Tetelestai," informing us that the blood of the most perfect Lamb has been shed once and for all. So within this cross, within his death, we find victory. For Jesus says, "It is finished," to you and to me, so that we can fully surrender to God's call in our life. Jesus says, "Tetelestai," in order that we would accept that God has given us new life. Jesus makes this declaration so that we can be confident in whatever struggles we're experiencing and whatever hardships we might be encountering, that victory has been won. And so the question is, what if we were to begin to make that claim for ourselves? What if we were to begin to see Christ's victory all around us in our suffering, in our own place of distress, in our own place of darkness? What if we can see that tetelestai, it is finished, and make that claim with confidence? You know, just last week I walked into my son Zach's room, and it was in the midst of, you know, everything kind of just starting to go crazy in our world, right? And I found Zach, he was stretched out on the floor, and he had his legs propped up on the wall, and he's scrolling through his phone. He's looking at his news feed, and he's clearly not happy. And, you know, I don't know if you know my son, but he has this major obsession with theme parks. And so he was upset, and he kept saying to me as he's scrolling through, he's like, "Dad, they closed Magic Kingdom. Dad, they closed Epcot. Dad, they closed Universal. They closed SeaWorld." And I didn't know what to tell him. And he was devastated. And I felt like I had no words other than just to say, "Zach, I'm sorry. Everything's going to be okay." But it just sounded so cliche, you know? And so Zach's continuing to scroll through his phone. He doesn't even look at me. And he just says, all of a sudden, "Hey, Dad, you know what won't close?" I was like, "What?" He goes, "Waffle House." So I thought, okay, well, there's something positive there. We can go with that. Of course, that was until the next day when Zach came in and announced to me that they had just closed 365 Waffle Houses. And we were right back to where we were. I thought he was going to lose his mind, and I just didn't know what to do. I mean, all I saw in the eyes of my beloved son was defeat and tragedy and loss. And I felt helpless. But then Zach said something to me that I will never forget. He said, "Dad, you know who I was thinking about today?" And I asked him who, and he said, "I was thinking about Miss Dot." See, I don't know if you know Miss Dot, but she's one of our greeters, and she stands at the front door, and she's someone who always has this giant grin on her face. And whenever you walk in, she just embraces you with this warm and loving hug. And while Miss Dot has this amazing youthful spirit, she does fall into this category that we would call high risk. And that's what Zach was thinking about. And he said, "You know, I was thinking about Miss Dot, and I was thinking about Miss Rita." And he goes, "I was even thinking about Pastor Leanne. She's old, right?" And then he says, he goes, she's in her 50s, right?" And so I told my son the truth. I said, "Yes, Zach, Pastor Leanne is in her 50s. But then he says to me, "You know, Dad, with all of this happening, with everything closing all around us, I know that we're staying home to keep Miss Dodd and Miss Rita and Pastor Leanne safe. And I want them to be okay. And so this is a good thing." And do you see it? In that moment, he went from defeat to triumph. He went from tragedy to victory because now he had something that he was fighting for. He wasn't burdened by all of the hurt. Instead, he put his focus on hope, and that hope is what will carry him through to the other side. He saw victory in the suffering. So I'll finish with this morning. I want you to think about this. Rarely do we ever give the image of a cross a second thought. We take it for granted, friends. I mean, for us, that symbol of a cross, it's the marker of what we put our faith into. It's almost like the logo of our church, right? I mean, we put it as followers of Christ on everything, on our letterheads, on our bumper stickers, on our t-shirts. We even have it on our wall outside of our church. We even have a giant one in our front lawn, right? We just naturally never think about the symbol of what it stands for, or maybe what it stood for. See, for so many on that day of Christ's crucifixion, that cross, it was an image of defeat. It was this image of terror. And I wonder how many people were standing there hearing Christ's cries of pain and anguish, and they were thinking, "This is horrible. This is terrible. What are we going to do? This is the worst thing that could happen to us right now." But we know that Jesus says tetelestai. And what that means is that Christ wins. And so I wonder if we were standing there at the foot of that cross with everyone, would we be saying, no, you're wrong. It's beautiful. This is inspiring. It's the best thing that could ever happen to us. Friends, we carry that image of the cross with us wherever we go. We carry that image in all things and at all times. We bear the image of that cross in our quarantine and in all of the uncertainty and fear and monotony that comes along with it. But by the cross, I don't mean that we carry this burden of this instrument of death. No, what we're saying this morning is that we carry a symbol, we carry this reminder, this image of triumph. For friends, we have been made free. Take a deep breath. Because we have received new life. And we forever, in whatever circumstance we find ourselves because of that cross, we can find victory in all things. And we do this because Jesus with confidence claims to tetelestai, it is finished. You know, in a moment, we'll go into a time of prayer. And, you know, as we said last week, we don't have the ability to gather together around the table physically and to share in the sacrament of Holy Communion as one in one place. But we do share in the spirit of this as we gather together in worship. And so before I go into our liturgy and our prayer, I want to invite you to think about something. It's something that I was thinking about from my past as a youth director this week, about being on these mission trips. And we would gather together as a youth group and have these times of devotion each night. And one of the first things that we would do is we would ask ourselves, hey, where did you see God today? We do that, you know, to check in on one another, to make sure how each other was, but we also were doing it to remind each other that in this different setting that we find ourselves, and in some cases, in this challenging setting, that God was still present. In fact, God was so tangible, you couldn't avoid it. And so I want to ask you right now, if you're watching this live, go into your comments right now and type in there where you have seen God this week. Let's share that together as a community. Let's share our stories of how we continue, even in this current situation, to see God present and alive and at work because Christ is victorious. And so often we view communion as this time where Jesus gathers with his disciples because of what's getting ready to happen in terms of his arrest and his crucifixion. And so because he's going away, he gives them this act to share in together to remember who he was and remember how present and real God is within us. But it also is a meal shared in triumph. Because it's not just remembering who Christ was in his earthly form. It's remembering who Christ was as God in the flesh. For 3 days later, he lives. And that's the victory that we celebrate. And so Jesus took bread. And he gives thanks to God. And he breaks the bread. He says, take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Whenever you do this, remember me. And when supper was over, he took the cup. And again, he gave thanks to God. And he said, "This is the blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's pray. Heavenly and gracious God, in these moments, we ask that you transform these elements and you transform the space in which we're gathered. You transform the distance in which we're experiencing, and you make it all full of your presence, your spirit, your hope, and your sense of victory. Heavenly and gracious God, help us to breathe in your love and to breathe out all fear, all anxiety, and all questions. That we might sit together. Maybe we're gathered by ourselves in front of a computer. Maybe we're gathered with a few friends in front of the TV. Maybe we're sitting together with our family. But in this moment, let us feel that connection, not just with the people we're present with, but let us feel this connection with our community at large. That you, Lord, are not defeated. That you, God, ultimately win over all things. And let that truth be something that we see in the midst of all that we're surrounded with right now. Let that reality be something that carries us this week. And so, God, in our communion with one another, fill us with new life and connect us together as one. That we rest in the truth that you win. For it's in your holy name that we pray. Friends, I hope that you are feeling that sense where you can see all around you a glimpse of Christ's victory. And so, Lynn, we hear you, that you've seen how people have reached out to each other with words of love and concern. We see you, Debbie, saying that these Facebook Live devotionals and worship songs have been a glimpse of God's glory to you. Joanna, we hear you, that you're beginning to embrace nature in the midst of a slowed down world. Rita, we see that you're seeing within your family that you are staying safe. Virginia, we know that you find victory when you look into the eyes of your son. Debbie, we know that you're finding victory in friendships and in nature. Gina, that cardinal that you saw, a symbol of God's victory in all of this. And so as we sing our final worship song this morning, I ask that wherever you are, if you feel comfortable staying seated, that's fine, but I almost feel like we should be standing during this song. And so I invite you in these moments to stand up if you wish and to sing out loud this declaration that no matter where we are, tetelestai, it is finished. Jesus is victorious. And so let's sing.
the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail.
So now, wherever you are, we invite you to hold out your hands in a posture of prayer as we close in our benediction together this morning. And so may we go forward from this place, believing in the victory of Christ, that even the cross and death itself do not win. And that within this transformed symbol and within this reality of Christ's love and life, we can find victory in our lives. And so carry that message into your families, into the community. Carry that message into the world. We pray for your safety and your well-being, and we pray that we see you again next week. And so go in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Have a great week, everyone.